Listening Library presents Bucking the Sarge by Christopher Paul Curtis, read for you by Michael Boatman. Chapter 1, My Life Listing.
Luther T. Farrell, you got to be more careful.
Sparky climbed into the front seat and slapped something brown and squarish on the dashboard of my ride.
My wallet!
My hand flew to the back of my jeans and patted the pocket where my wallet was supposed to have been. Stupid. I know. I snatched my wallet and opened it to see if anything was missing. I felt like I'd been gut-punched. Except for one thing. It was completely empty.
Aw, man! Someone jacked me! Where'd you get it? On the floor in Mrs. Bohannon's lab?
I'd been in Mrs. Bohannon's lab after my last class. She'd been trying to help me develop a knockout science fair project, and she was almost as excited about it as I was. If I came up with a great idea, I'd be the first student ever to win the science fair for 3 years in a row at Whittier Middle School, and probably the first at any school in Flint.
It had to be one of those chemistry geeks who'd picked my pocket. I bet it was that Lucas Sarge.
Sparky said,
You know what, Luther? I didn't think it was possible. But if word of this gets out, your reputation will sink even lower than it was before. You know, everybody already thinks there's something wrong with you the way you stress out over that science fair. But if I let people know you lost your wallet, you wouldn't just be known as a wannabe brainiac. You'd have the rep for being an absent-minded wannabe brainiac.
Sparky, this isn't any time to be joking around.
I'm gonna be in some big trouble.
Sparky said,
And ever since you were in Pampers, who is it that's had your back? Who's been there with you through the fire, to the limit, to the wall?
I tuned Sparky out and started worrying about what my mother, a.k.a. the Sarge, was going to say when she found out all my stuff had been ripped off. No, let me break that down. It wasn't what she was going to say that had me worried. It was what she was going to do. The Sarge's discipline techniques aren't the kind of thing you'd learn on the parenting network. They're more like what you'd pick up from watching the Animal Channel. Sparky kept running his mouth.
But I don't expect any thanks. It's just another case of me selflessly bailing my boy out.
I said, How are you bailing me out? How's you giving me an empty wallet supposed to be bailing me out?
It wasn't completely empty.
Here it comes. Sparky was about to say something about the only thing the thief had left in my wallet. I'm not ashamed. I'm not trying to hide anything.
It was a condom.
To be real, it was the oldest condom on the face of the earth. It had been in my wallet so many years that I'd had to give it a name. I called it Chauncey. Chauncey and that wallet had spent so much time together that it would have been a crime to separate them. Not that there was any chance of that happening anytime soon. They'd been together so long that Chauncey had wore a circle right in the leather, and a circle ain't nothing but a great big zero, which was just about my chances of ever busting Chauncey loose and using him. I said, Man, the Sarge is gonna kill me. Sparky said,
Maybe it's not as bad as you think. Maybe this'll help.
He snapped his fingers like a magician, and a card appeared. I took it from him. It figures. My library card. What's a thief gonna do with a library card? Sparky said,
I can understand why they left you that. But what I don't get is why they left that condom. Old as that baby is, I bet they could have got some good money from a museum for it.
Sparky snapped his fingers again. This time, my driver's license appeared.
Whew.
The Sarge had to pull some serious strings to get me that. If I'd have had to go apply for another one, it wouldn't have been good. Sparky started reading from my license.
Height, 6'4". Weight, 135.
He snorted and said, Yeah, maybe if you had 20 pounds of quarters in your pockets.
And here's something I don't get. If I'm a few months older than you, and I'm only 15, how come this license says you're 18?
Even though I treat Sparky like a brother, the Sarge taught me that there are some things that aren't anybody else's business. I said,
Connections, my brother. Connections.
Sparky said,
I guess so.
He snapped again and read from the piece of paper that magically appeared in his hand. It was the title to my ride.
Yeah, you really would need some serious connections to be 15 years old and have an $85,000 ride that's already paid off.
He shook his head and handed me my title. He snapped again. This finger popping was starting to get old, but at least every time he did it, it meant I was getting something back. Sparky was holding 3 credit cards, Oh, snap! Sparky handed me my JCPenney's card, my Platinum MasterCard, and my American Express Gold card. That was just about everything. Just about. I waited for another pop. Sparky was torturing me. Finally, he snapped again, and a $50 bill was in his fingers. It wasn't what I was really looking for, but 50 bucks is 50 bucks. It was my emergency money. He handed it to me and said, "I know I'm supposed to be your boy, and I know we swore to have each other's backs from womb to tomb, from birth to earth, but after going through your wallet, I gotta let you know something, my brother." "What's that?" "You need to quit all that whining about how rough your life is." I said, "Look who's talking." "Nah, Luther, I'm for real." I told him, "Buckle your seatbelt, Sparky. You know I gotta pick up my crew by 4. Sparky buckled his belt as I pulled away from the curb. I always parked a few blocks away from the school. We'd had this conversation about who was better off before. We look at things in different ways, but we always stay tight. Sparky's been my main dog since kindergarten. His real name is Dewey, but he outgrew that around 2nd grade. His father used to be a fireman, and since their crib was just around the corner from the firehouse, his dad let him walk down there after school and polish the bell and do other cool things all the time. After his dad got shot, the other firemen still let Sparky hang around and always had something for him to do. Darnell Dixon, the Sarge's go-to guy and my boss and one of Flint's leading psychopath nut jobs, had told Dewey, "It's a crying shame the way they treat you down at that fire station, young blood. Word is that the way you hang out there so much, they think of you like some little mascot. Fact is, they've been calling you Sparky the Fire Dog behind your back." That's one reason I have so much respect for Sparky. Darnell called himself trying to be hateful, but Sparky flipped the script on him. He took the name and wore it with honor. He was proud of the firemen because they always made him feel at home and mostly because they reminded him of his pops. So from the time he was 7 years old, he made everyone call him Sparky. I turned left onto Court Street. Sparky said, "Nah, Luther, you got it straight up made. Stop and think about it. You know how you always making them lists for everything you gonna do and everything you wanna do? If I sat down and made my own list of the top 100 things that I'd ever wanted in life, you'd already have 98 of them." Sparky started ticking things off on his fingers. 1, you're toting all that plastic around, and I know that MX car don't even have a limit. 2, you got your own vehicle. 3, you got a for real, honest to God, straight from the Secretary of State phony driver's license that says you're 18 when we both know you're only 15, and an immature 15 at that. 4, you kiss every teacher in school's behind and get good grades. 5, you carry 50 bucks in your wallet at all times. 6, your mama owns half the ghetto. 7, she's got them group homes. 8, she's got so much cash she lends money out like a bank. 9, you got $6 million she set aside in that education fund. I interrupted. Being real, it's $92,510, and that's $92,510 for more than 2 years of 80-hour weeks. Sparky said, "Whatever. Number 10, she bought that bad 53-inch plasma TV." Sparky ran out of fingers, so he started slapping the dashboard. 11, bam, she had Darnell Dixon hook you up with that free satellite. 12, bam, don't no one care if you watch high-definition cartoons from sunup to sundown. 13, bam, you're gonna inherit all them things from her. And that's just the start. You got it all, baby." I rolled my eyes. Sparky said, "Of course, you do have a couple things going on that wouldn't make my list." I said, "A couple? How about having to look after a bunch of grown men 24/7? Sparky said, "And for number 2, the way you have to clean those dudes up and change some of their diapers." I said, "And 3, having to work all day Saturday and Sunday and from 4 till midnight every other night." Sparky said, "And 4, when it comes to basketball, you're a waste of 6 feet and 4 inches. I said, "And 5, having to make sure my crew gets shaved, dressed, washed up, medicated, driven to the rehab center, and driven to their doctor's appointments and therapy sessions. Then there's prepping and painting the rental houses for new tenants and cleaning the..." Sparky said, "And 6, there's the thing about you not being exactly the best-looking brother in Flint."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.